Welcome in to the Punt and Pass podcast. I'm your host, Drew Butler, joined alongside my co-host, Jake Fromm. Be sure to follow us on social media. We are at Punt and Pass on X and Instagram. I'm at Drew Butler. He's at Fromm Jake. Puntandpass.com, the number one destination for all things college football. What a weekend it was. A huge one in Athens. Really, the eyes and ears of the college football world were Zoom focused on the Georgia-Tennessee game that took place inside Sanford Stadium. I was there, Jake. It was awesome. We're going to recap that big dog's victory as well and touch on some of the other things that went down this weekend. A lot to get to. We're going to have a great show. How are you, brother?
Hey, doing great, coming off a big win at home against the Jacksonville Jaguars. Things are great. Vibes are good. Thanksgiving is almost here.
I know, I can't wait.
We're getting towards the tail end there of November. College football was great this weekend. I know we're going to spend a lot of time talking about Georgia-Tennessee, but a lot of other interesting things did happen. Can't wait to dive into it.
That is absolutely true. I went 4-1 on my picks last weekend. The only pick I got wrong was Tennessee plus 10.5. The Dogs, of course, won the game 31-17. Jake, you said a big win at home for the Detroit Lions, 52-6 over the Jacksonville Jaguars. I've got something else. If you want to be a winner at home and you're listening to this podcast right now, you need to get on over to Solomon Brothers Jewelers. This episode of Punt and Pass presented to you by our awesome partners over at Solomon Brothers Jewelers. Jake, you just said it. Thanksgiving's next week. The holiday season's here. Engagement season is here. And if you need to get an engagement ring or a wedding band, this weekend is the one at Solomon Brothers. It is the Tacori Bridal Event, November 22nd through the 24th. You can get up to $10,000 cash back on Tacori engagement and rings and wedding bands, or you can get up to 3 years of interest-free financing. Solomon Brothers has GIA-certified diamonds in the Tacori Bridal Event. It's going on this weekend, November 22nd through the 24th, at all three locations: Buckhead, Alpharetta, and Sharpsburg. The Tacori Bridal Event is happening. Tell them Punt and Pass sent you. Again, you can get up to $10,000 cash back on Tacori engagement rings and wedding bands. It's the weekend. Go do it. Be a winner at home like the Detroit Lions. Shout out Solomon Brothers. SolomonBrothers.com, at Solomon Brothers on social media. Yeah, let's just start with the game, Jake. I mean, it was absolutely incredible. What an atmosphere. I saw a tweet that SEC Nation and College Game Day, and I think one other activation through ESPN. It was only the seventh time ever that all of those productions have been in the same place. They usually kind of dot the board, but it was the biggest game of the college football weekend. Georgia shuts out Tennessee in the second half. They win 31-17. Carson Beck, he did what he had to do. A great showing by him. Kirk Herbstreit was giving major love to Mike Bobo for the offensive game plan. A lot to break down here, Jake. What are your first thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, you could just feel the atmosphere through the TV watching it. You know, we had meetings, you know, at home, so we got to watch a little bit at the beginning of the game and then took a little break hiatus and then got to watch the second half. So, but it was just so fun kind of catching back up and watching this game, seeing kind of go down early and then come back and just – and really just dominate the rest of that game after that 10-0, like, deficit. Second half was phenomenal. Exactly what you want to see out of a playoff and championship caliber team and a tough and physical team, of just saying, hey, we're going to go in, we're going to make adjustments. Coaching staff did a great job making adjustments and then just dominating the line of scrimmage. The biggest thing I think Tennessee had advantage wise was the line of scrimmage in the run game and on defense, their front seven getting to the quarterback. And let me tell you, man, our bigs came out to play. They came out hair on fire, and they balled out. They met all expectations of how they were going to play and some, and did a great job.
No question about it. The offensive game plan was certainly something that Georgia fans wanted to see. I know a lot of people clamor for deep shots, come out ripping it, and they did exactly that. I mean, I thought Arian Smith should have caught that ball on the first play of the drive. It kind of sucked the juice out of the stadium. Two straight three and outs. There were boo birds. Tennessee, great start for them. You got to give them credit. Nico Iamaleava, that's the first time I've seen the kid in person, Jake. He can spin it. The dude's like legit 6'5". He's got super long arms. You're like, wow, this kid has what it takes. There's no question about it. He's even pretty mobile as well. He was getting outside the pocket. But Georgia responded in a big way. The fans were a major, major part of the atmosphere. It was sick. The fireworks at night, the fireworks during the national anthem, the light show, the juice in the stadium from a music perspective. I got to give credit to the whole staff at Georgia, because I think that, one, they've listened to some of the constructive criticism that the fans have maybe been giving them throughout this season. And again, this season has lacked really an exciting home game, but it almost seems like they've also implemented some of the things that they've seen having played in so many big time road atmospheres so far this season. At Tuscaloosa, I was there. That was crazy. At Texas, I was talking to people pregame. They were saying that was one of the wildest games they've ever seen. You know, you got to go back to the Peach or the Chick-fil-A kickoff game or whatever you want to call it, the Affleck kickoff game, that Kentucky game at night. They just played in so many big games. They implemented a lot of those things into the atmosphere. It was great. It played a big part. Getting Carson Beck outside of the pocket, a lot of those kind of rollout looks, to me, it freed him up. Jake, he was loose. I felt like he saw the field way better. I feel like it gave the receivers an opportunity to maybe sit in some open zones when the coverage presented itself, or maybe break off a route and run to space when they were locked up in man coverage. It just seemed to really get the offense going, and it gave Carson the confidence to be able to throw the ball downfield. Nate Frazier did a good job stepping in with no ETN. And the defense stepped up big time. I mean, they were in a 10-0 deficit. I said it. The Boo Birds were out. You're like, uh-oh, where's this going to go? And they stepped up big, big, big time, and they shut Tennessee out in the second half.
Yeah, I'm so glad you brought Carson up, because we have to give him his flowers, super well-deserving for how he played. Maybe all he needed was a home game, a big-time home game, get things going. But, you know, kind of like you alluded to a little bit, I mean, the start – wasn't great. I think he was like 5 or 13 or something to start. You know, Arian arguably should have caught that first shot play down the left side, but he just kept going, kept chopping wood.
Yep.
Kept spinning it, kept throwing it. Had conviction all night throwing balls. Let me tell you, the seam bender to Oscar Delp in the end zone for a touchdown.
Yeah.
You don't throw that ball unless you have confidence in your guy to be in that spot and conviction of seeing it how you want to see it and being able to throw it into that spot. So to me, that is a big, big time throw, man. And he did it with his legs as well. I think that first down run he had in the field kind of got everybody juiced up. And then he had, you know, that scramble touchdown run later in the game.
Yeah,
man, great job. Great responding. And if he continues to play that way, I mean, now we're talking about a national championship caliber team just based on the performance of our quarterback.
Talking about that seam bender, I was down on the field when I saw that throw. He like dropped it right over a linebacker. The ball kind of lays into Delp's only area where Delp can catch it. Talk about you guys as quarterbacks, how much you work on that throw, because the precision that you have to be able to get it over the second level of the defense, but then have the ball drop so it's catchable. That's a really, really tough pass.
Oh yeah, man. It's beautiful. There's an art to it. You got to have arc and pace. You got to have a little bit of touch in your game to be able to get it over a second level defender, but being able to get there in time before a third level defender can go and make a play on the ball. So those balls are so fun and so just, let me just say this, satisfying as a quarterback to be able to throw, get into a spot and make a big play. So great job by those guys. You can tell that they've done it, got a lot of reps doing it. And it's really cool to see as a fan it come to fruition on the field.
No question. Carson Beck, 25 of 40, 347, 2 touchdowns, no interceptions. He also had a rushing touchdown, no fumbles. So a clean game, a couple of shot plays that you think probably should have been caught. I mean, we talked about Arian on the first play of the game, but then right before half, how badly do you want that one back as a quarterback? Dominic Lovett wide open, and Carson just put a little bit too much air under it.
Yeah, that was tough.
Still got 3 points, though, which was huge. I mean, everybody was kind of super bummed out in the stadium. I was like, it's fine. Let's just get 3 points and go to halftime tied.
Yeah, but those are the plays you talk about as a team. Those are four-point plays, right? Third downs in the low red, a four-point play, because if you don't score a touchdown, you get a field goal, right? Seven minus three, 4 points there. So you want to score touchdowns in the red zone. That is the goal of every OC and every offense. That's just tough. I mean, it kind of is what it is. He knew there was a safe spot there. Wasn't necessarily seeing the whole thing. Didn't want to throw an interception before half. Hey, I get it. We've all been there. It sucks. It is what it is. I do want to say they did a great job, center, QB, and the offensive line, and offensive skill as a whole, of using cadence to try to negate Tennessee's defensive line of teeing off on the quarterback. There were no sacks in this game, and that's crazy. A testament to everybody. Skill players not jumping and being able to use cadence, getting open in routes. Obviously, Carson in the offensive line, you know, that's simple and obvious. But, man, that is a fantastic job. And, man, their best guys didn't play their best, and our guys met up to the challenge.
No, you're exactly right. A clean game is exactly what it was, and it was so good to see the tight ends get activated. Lawson Lucky and Oscar Delt, they had big days. Oscar obviously had two receiving touchdowns, which was absolutely huge. 4 catches, 56 yards for him. Ben Jurosik, 5 catches, 51 yards, and Lawson Lucky had that catch for 23 yards. Good news for Georgia, Dylan Bell. It looks like that injury not as bad as they thought. I don't know if Trevor Etienne's going to be back anytime soon. He obviously didn't play, but Nate Frazier, 19 carries, 68 yards, and a touchdown. Georgia's defense. Look, Dylan Sampson still got his. The kid's an absolute stud. 19 carries, 101 yards, and a touchdown. But they held Nico to no touchdowns. Nico was 20 of 33 for 167. They just limited those big breakout plays, which was a huge determining factor, because Tennessee was holding on to the ball, man. I mean, that time of possession, that drive that they had in the fourth quarter where they ended up wanting to go for it on fourth down.
That was
then they
huge.
Got a false start. Huge. Then they punted. That was it. And then Georgia took the air out of the ball and does what Georgia has done so many times in the past to ice a game.
Yeah, just completely ate up the clock, went down, converting third downs, and score a touchdown. I mean, that's just how you just put the knife in it and twist it a little bit to just kill the other team and any of their hopes and dreams of coming back in this football game. I do want to talk about both defenses here. Give props to Tennessee's defense. I did not know this. I saw this graphic during the game. The last 10 games, they had not given up over 20 points.
I said that on the podcast last week. Isn't that crazy?
That is big time. That is huge. Forgive me for not digesting that information and memorizing it. And then two, you know who was such a pleasant surprise to see out there on the field and making plays? Smile Munden, number two, playing the backer spot there for the Dogs. Man, great to see him around showing up. He was all over the place. I think he made a huge difference. And I think Malachi Starks also had much better performance playing in this football game.
That drive I was talking about, Tennessee, 12 plays, 36 yards, 6 minutes and 13 seconds in the fourth quarter.
With no points.
And they punted it away. Yep. Georgia gets the ball back, 12 plays, 92 yards, 6 minutes and 21 seconds off the clock, 31-17 game over at that point. You're giving flowers to the defense. We've talked about how good the offense looked. How about my boy Brett Thorson with that tackle on that?
I cannot wait. You were going to bring it up. You have to, right?
Yeah. That was a hell of a tackle. And I don't know what the hell the gunner was doing. I think it was Arian Smith. Great punt. Great hang time. They're just freaking staring at the dude. I mean, that's like day one training camp stuff. When you're doing punt drills, you run through the guy's legs. He obviously didn't do that. That is a really good returner as well. Boo Carter, he breaks it out. And Thorson in the open field, man, squares his ass up, brings him to the ground. I was like, I don't know if I would have made that one. That was a really good tackle.
Well, Brett, he had to get his. I mean, how many returns have they had this year?
Crazy.
Right. So, hey, I'm not going to get very many opportunities. I got to show up on tape. And I think that works both ways. You know, obviously for Thorson saying, hey, I got to go get mine. And then, hey, I feel for Arian. I mean, who has returned it? I don't know. So I'm not necessarily prepared.
Exactly.
I get it. I understand. I understand.
Huge game for Georgia, though. So they get UMass coming up this weekend. And now that Georgia Tech game Friday night after Thanksgiving has a big time magnifying glass on it. Do not get it twisted, folks. Brent Key would sell his children on the black market to beat Georgia in Athens and knock them out of the college football playoff. It's going to be a really good game. So Georgia has a little bit of a get right week coming up against UMass, and then they welcome in the enemy Georgia Tech Friday night after Thanksgiving. Around the SEC, Texas takes care of business. Tough little spot there. Arkansas held their own. Arkansas covered the 13.5 points. How about Florida?
Big time.
Smoking LSU. They've got new life down in Gainesville. DJ Lagway is a stud. I'll just say it right now. The Dogs got very lucky that Lagway got injured in that game because this dude is the real deal. They are a totally different football team with him at quarterback, Jake.
Yeah, man, they played really well. And something odd and interesting about this game, LSU dominated the time of possession in this game. It was like nearly 40 minutes to 20 minutes, maybe even more than that. It was kind of bizarre and kind of crazy. But, man, Florida rolling, owned the second half in that football game. DJ Lagway's a stud. I don't know. I keep going back to him getting injured in that game. To me, it's just a little bit.
I know.
It's a little fishy. It's just weird. It's just odd. But he's
at least he didn't play against Texas, to his credit. I mean, if he would have played against Texas, that would have been weird.
It looked a little weird.
How about Florida? They're hosting Ole Miss this weekend at noon. Like that's going to be a game.
That is a game. I mean, if Ole Miss wants a shot in this college football playoff, if Tennessee wants a spot, I mean, Twitter is just going crazy right now. All these scenarios and, hey, who wins? Who has the better wins? Who has the worst losses? But, hey, before we start moving on and get too far away from this Georgia-Tennessee game, Drew, I want to get your thoughts. Yeah. Ball's Twitter right now is going crazy about all the missed calls, quote-unquote. You know, should have been this. What's your take? You were there. Get your perspective as a spectator. Give mine too as seeing on TV and get to see a little more replays.
Well, it should come as no surprise that I am an extremely harsh officiating critic. I hold these guys feet to the fire because they have zero accountability. So I'll be the guy that holds them accountable. I was in the press box next to longtime NFL referee, and he's also officiated Super Bowls, Jerome Boger. He was up there working on behalf of I don't even know who. But I was next to him on the Delp catch, which was ruled incomplete. Tennessee fans thought it was a fumble. And Boger looks at the review and he goes, immediately he said, that's not a catch. He never has possession of it. He's clearly bringing the ball into his waist. The ball is still moving in his hands as he's trying to bring it into his waist. Then it gets smacked out. He was like, that is an incomplete catch, as true as possible. Now, I saw that tweet thread that you sent me, Jake. Yeah, the refs messed up a bunch of calls. And did they all go Georgia's favor? I guess so. Look, I was on the field when that kickoff, I thought
that was bad.
Was out of bounds. I thought it was out of bounds. I mean, I was looking at it. I was like, he just hit that way out of bounds. And the refs just blew it as a touchback. And that was right before half, I think. So I think Tennessee could have had an opportunity maybe to run two plays with a timeout and get 3 points on the board. So that was a miss. I saw one about a face mask. I don't know if.
Yeah, the face mask one, I don't know. I mean, I don't think you're allowed.
Here's the end-all, be-all, Jake. Referees are awful. So, that's it. They all suck. And this weekend went in Georgia's favor.
I about to say, as a Georgia fan, I've seen it go. And as a former player, trust me, I've been on the wrong side of it. And about time something went our way a little bit. The two that are just blatant obvious to me that I cannot believe didn't get called were the kickoff and then the Carson false start.
Yeah, that was horrible.
On the third down. That was like,
that's a 100% false start. How do you not throw that flag?
Yeah, that's just because you're not looking for it. How often does that come up, right? For a referee to have your eyes on that, I don't know. I just about time kind of things went away. Hey, I get it. The conspiracy here is that college football, the committee really wanted Georgia to win that game. So they're in the college football playoff. There's no hope for them if they don't win that game. I don't know. I've never been on the side where anybody is willing to help us get into the college football playoff. So that's new to me.
Look, you beat them by 14 points, right? Like if it was 3 points here or there, and there was some calls that really, really swung what could have been the outcome of the game. Look, I'm here for it. Like send me all of your officiating qualms. I will settle them for you. For example, did you watch the Falcons game yesterday? One of the worst calls I've ever seen. I don't know how on earth they could deem that a catch and a fumble. He didn't have possession of the football, and then the Broncos take it and move right down the field and score a touchdown. So look, it is what it is. I've had people listening to this podcast be like, dude, Drew, drop it. You talk about it every time. I'm like, somebody needs to hold these people accountable. So Watching again right now, the kickoff. I mean, I guess the ref had the best line of demarcation since he was right there on the pylon, but man, it did not look good. And then the false start, you're exactly right. Third down, like that is a false start 100 times out of 100. So interesting for sure. Florida looking good, though. They're hosting Ole Miss this weekend. Mississippi is a 10.5-point favorite on the road. Man, I like Florida in that spot for sure. Mizzou loses to South Carolina. South Carolina scores late. That was a big one. So South Carolina, man, they've got some new life over there, too. Man. I thought the game would be close. I thought they might lose it, but they're doing it, Jake.
I mean, they're a three-loss team. They lost to Alabama. They lost that weird home game to LSU.
Yes, they should have beat Alabama. They should have beat LSU.
They should have. Yeah. So, I mean, I think they're a good football team. Like, we talked about it last week. Their quarterback's a stud. Is there a way they get in? I don't know. I was scrolling through Twitter last night. Peter Burns tweets out. There's, kind of his college football playoff kind of predictor thing. He's like, there's four teams from the Big Ten. That'll be
really?
Oregon,
four from the Big
Ohio
Ten?
State, Penn State, Indiana. That's who we think gets in. Notre Dame, the Big 12 champ, the ACC champ, a group of five team. That's eight spots. And now there's four teams from this
South
list.
South Carolina in there.
From the SEC. Georgia, Alabama, Ole Miss, Texas, A&M, Tennessee, South Carolina.
South Carolina. So he adds South Carolina to the list. I think out of that list, and I would argue maybe depending on what happens, Ohio State, Indiana coming up this weekend. If Ohio State lays it on them, Indiana could be in a bad position because their schedule is terrible. Yeah. Texas obviously plays Texas A&M. We're going to get to that tiebreaker website here in just a second, but you know, Notre Dame, do they get under the magnifying glass with that awful loss at home against Northern Illinois?
Illinois, yeah.
I don't know, but you're starting to see, and I can't wait to see what some of the predictions are on Tuesday night's rankings release show. Think about this, okay? My brain's going crazy now. You could have Colorado play at Georgia in the first round of the playoffs. You mean to tell me that wouldn't be sick with Shador, Travis Hunter, and Coach Prime, night game in Athens? That would be must see TV. That would be an incredible match.
I mean, that would sell, right? I mean, that would be great for TV, great for tickets. And kind of on this, because everything's driven by the dollar, I think the committee has to kind of come out and set criteria, set precedent like they do in all these different courts and hearings, all the stuff. You got to set precedents here and say, who you play matters and who you beat matters because we want to continue as a fan, continue to see big time games and big time matchups and programs setting these non-conference games up. That's what we want to see. Yep. We want to see Oregon kind of come out and go play Texas to open up the season, you know, in Dallas or something like that. We want to see those games as a fan. And I think you have to make it, as the committee, like, reward people for going out and doing that. So I would love to see that happen kind of moving forward. And a lot of it's going to play itself out. But, I mean, there's going to be some heartbroken fans, teams, coaches, players get hurt in this deal, getting left out.
I was really not surprised, but I was kind of like, uh-oh, I was getting an uneasy feeling about it. Even on Friday, Feinbaum was in Athens. McAfee was in Athens. A lot of interviews were taking place with Josh Brooks, the athletic director, Jerry Moorhead, the university president. Kirby Smart was on McAfee, and they were out there actively stumping on a Friday before the game. Hey, man, look at our schedule. Look who we've had to play. Look at the gauntlet that we've been through. They were sitting there saying, we should not be ranked 12th right now. And I totally agree. You have to stick up for yourself. There's no doubt a guy like Josh Brooks has to advocate for his program and then just focus on the game. But when Kirby's out there openly talking about it pregame,
before and after.
I was like, I don't know if I like this. And then after the game, he says to Laura Rutledge, I want anybody on the committee to come into the SEC and go play on the road. Like you don't know what it takes. You don't know how hard it is week in and week out. And to Georgia's point specifically, the teams that they've had to play. I mean, that was another ranked victory for them. They lost to a top five ranked Alabama team on the road. They lost to a top 15 Ole Miss team on the road. They beat the number one team, Texas, on the road. Like, they have had to go through it this year. So I give them props for, one, kicking ass on Saturday. I mean, that's the first and foremost thing. But two, sticking for themselves. They, hey, man, we should not be 12. We should be in this playoff. And now, of course, that Tech game looms very, very large. So that was a big part of it. And now the question becomes, Jake, do you even want to play in the SEC championship game? Is it advantageous at all? I was riding down the elevator, and Greg Sankey walked into the elevator in the press box when I was leaving the game. I didn't say anything to him. He, like, had his head in his phone, kind of head down. I didn't, like, give him a noogie and put him in a headlock or something. I probably should have. Could have done that. But he was on Feinbaum earlier in the week, and I couldn't believe what he said with a straight face, how it's only advantageous to go to the conference championship game in the SEC. It's such a high honor to be in the SEC. He's saying this on the air, and I'm like, do you not remember what happened to Georgia just a year ago? 42-game win streak, lose by three on a neutral site. Your only loss of the season, and it got Georgia knocked out of the college football playoff. I just can't believe that they don't have the perspective to understand what they're saying. And this year specifically, Jake, the opportunity for Georgia, one, to clinch a playoff berth, host a home game, not have to play in the SEC championship game, and get a three-week break, that sounds pretty damn good to me, regardless who your opponent's going to be.
Yeah, as banged up as they are, I don't see how it's advantageous at all. Your team is well battle-tested. You know how they're going to react in these big-time games because you've had five of them this year. So that's – yeah, as a coach, if I'm Kirby, that's not an issue for me. I know how my guys are going to play, how they're going to respond. We've done it. We're battle tested. I mean, honestly, it's about getting healthy and getting better prepared.
Right.
Especially what happened, when they had all that going on, a chance for a three-peat, to go and do that and get kicked out of the college football playoffs. A travesty, and I can go back to my last two years, 18 and 19, playing the SEC championship and lose, and now we're ranked number five. I mean, first team out. I've been there. It sucks. You got to win the game you're in, but, man, losing in the SEC championship matters.
Yes, it does.
You don't want to do that.
And as it stands right now, I'm going back to the website we discussed last Thursday, bball.notnothing.net. It's MREDS 2024 SEC football standings tiebreaker algorithm. If the favorites win out the next 2 weeks, it is Texas versus Alabama in the SEC championship game. That, of course, would be Texas beating Texas A&M in that final game the Saturday after Thanksgiving. If Texas A&M wins that game against Texas and all the other favorites go, it is A&M versus Alabama. However, I switched up two games.
Uh-oh.
I said, okay, Auburn beats A&M this weekend in Kyle Field. I don't know. I just think Auburn's better than a 1-5 football team in the SEC. Yes, A&M's playing well. Would it shock you if Auburn beat A&M this weekend? I said, not really. So I said, all right, Auburn beats A&M. All the other favorites win. And then next week, Saturday after Thanksgiving, I said A&M lost a horrible game to Auburn. Now they get to play spoiler. They beat Texas. So A&M loses this weekend. A&M wins next weekend and beats Texas. All other favorites win. Dun, da, da. SEC championship game is Alabama versus Georgia.
You know who's going to get shafted in this? Is A&M, if they don't lose to Auburn and they beat Auburn, they lose to Texas.
Okay, A&M beats Auburn. A&M loses to Texas. They're out. That is that's a Texas versus Alabama SEC championship game.
And then A&M really is out of the college football playoff at that point. And they arguably
beat Auburn. Texas beats A&M, and then Auburn upsets Alabama. It's Texas versus Georgia rematch in the SEC championship game.
Wow.
There's just a lot of ways you can play with it. Again, a very fun website. I tweeted it out. Go check it out. MREDS 2024 SEC football standings tiebreaker machine. You know, again, would it shock you if Auburn beat Alabama inside Jordan-Hare in the Iron Bowl? To me, no, it wouldn't. And just one little wrinkle like that changes everything. So it'll be really interesting to see how things play out, Jake.
Hey, real quick hypothetical, just thinking here, you know, we're talking about a two-loss Tennessee team, a two-loss Ole Miss team. Do they find their way into the college football playoff? Say A&M wins out here, okay? A&M wins out. They beat Texas. Texas is no longer playing for an SEC championship. It's Texas A&M versus Alabama or something, right? I mean, does Texas find themselves on the outside looking in of these two-loss SEC teams being kicked out because their strength of schedule
out of
sucks?
The playoffs? Yeah, strength of schedule is awful. And let me just answer that for you shortly. Absolutely not, because the College Football Playoff Committee will do anything to keep the brand of Texas in a 12-team playoff. That's right?
I feel like they're getting kind of shooed in at this three spot. And is it how deserving is that? I don't know. The only time they've really played a big time football game this year, they got beat at home. Yep. They got whipped at home while losing the turnover battle.
Yep. Yep.
That's not good. Let me tell you in sports, if you win the turnover battle and lose the game handedly, usually that means you're not a good football team.
That's right. That's a bad, bad loss. No question about it. So much to still happen over the next 2 weeks. Again, great lineup this weekend. Ole Miss at Florida. That game is at noon. Kentucky at Texas. Texas, a big favorite there, 20.5 points. Missouri, Mississippi State, Alabama on the road at Oklahoma. That should be a good game. That's your 7:30 game on ABC. And then on ESPN at 7:30, A&M at Auburn. 7:45 SEC Network, Spunky Vanderbilt at Reeling LSU. So that should be good. And then, of course, in the Big Ten, a monster game, Ohio State against Indiana. 5-2 matchup. Right now, Ohio State is a 12.5 point favorite, Jake. So that will be a big one to watch as well. So much to come. I love Thanksgiving. Like, I'm already starting to get a couple of, let's circle back after the holidays emails in my work life. So, you know, that people are already starting to show. Well, it's such a late Thanksgiving this year, you know, November 28th.
Really,
so people are just wanting it to get here. I feel like later on this week, a lot of people will be shutting it down. My kids are out of school all next week too. So it's time, man. Best time of the year is here.
Man, it's coming. It's on the way. Real quick to finish up, kind of around the horn. Kansas beats BYU. I feel like BYU is kind of out of it now. Yep. Oregon barely escapes on the road at Wisconsin, 16-13. That was a scare. Their strength of schedule, other than Ohio State's not very good, Penn State's strength of schedule is not very good. They whip up on Purdue. And then, obviously, South Carolina, fourth quarter drive, comeback win at home against Missouri. That was huge. So
30 points in that fourth quarter too. 18 for Mizzou, 12 for South Carolina, I believe. Wow. So a lot of fireworks in that one. South Carolina gets a huge, huge win. All right. So Peter Burns is saying keep them on the outside looking in for a potential playoff spot, depending on what kind of chaos unfolds in the next 2 weeks. Hey, if you don't want chaos to unfold, if you don't want to be surprised by something in a bad way during the holiday season, you need to go to Solomon Brothers Jewelers.
That's right.
Thank you, Spencer. You knew exactly where I was going with that. You throw the graphic right up here on our YouTube channel. The reason why I say that is because if you've got big plans, say an engagement, say you want to get something very nice, got some big plans, you know, you want to get a nice piece of jewelry, an accessory for your significant other, head on over to Solomon Brothers. Simple as that. When you walk into a Solomon Brothers store, you tell them Punt and Pass sent you, you can get up to 20% off your jewelry purchase. Three amazing locations: Buckhead, Alpharetta, and Sharpsburg. And a final reminder, this weekend, November 22nd through the 24th, it is the Tacori Bridal event at all three Solomon Brothers locations. You can get up to $10,000 cash back on Tacori engagement rings and wedding bands, or 3 years of interest-free financing. The Tacori Bridal event includes GIA certified diamonds. This is your chance to absolutely get an amazing deal. The Tacori Bridal event at Solomon Brothers this weekend, November 22nd through 24th, all three locations. Check them out on social media at Solomon Brothers and at SolomonBrothers.com. I'm at Drew Butler. He's at From Jake. We're at Punt and Pass. Jake, anything on the way out, my man?
No, man, I think we hit it all. College football is coming down on the wire.
I know.
It's going to work itself out. Does it? I don't know.
It's going to be awesome. I said 2 weeks left in the regular season. It's crazy to think.
It's flying by.
Flying by. Let's enjoy it while we have it. That's why you listen to Punt and Pass. We keep you locked in every single week. Hope you enjoyed today's show. Thank you so much, Jake Fromm, and we will talk to you on Thursday. See you.
We out.